us. One thing is very clear from his exhaustive deliberation, and that is that no amount of act, no amount of rules, and also no amount of thinking from the government can solve the problem. It is the man and the citizen in individual, and then joining hands together can improve the situation in whatever condition one thinks for. That is what is the result. Mansagar restoration is definitely the result of this togetherness, and that is what he has asked for, that let us enjoy with togetherness to have such a great restoration of the biodiversity, because the wetlands are those places which are very important from the point of view of our development. If we really want to have development and not the destruction, then we would have to join hands to the citizens' movement. And that is why I would like that everyone joins hands, especially clap for such a great endeavor which has been performed by Dr. Ashok. Now I invite few of the invited lecture, few of the student lectures, oral presentation. Who is the one?
Gentlemen, firstly I want to salute Sir Harshvardhan for the endeavor he did for the lake. Because I have been visiting this place, I have been married outside India, and 8 years back I visited the place and it was really horrifying. This year again I visited and it was tremendously improved. So I salute him for his things. The title of this presentation is The Consequential Impacts of Industrialization on Biodiversity, and I will make a special reference to climate change on global food production and security. As we know, industrialization has carried with it the seeds of environmental damage, persisted and abated by both needs and greed of man. Unplanned and haphazard industrialization has substantially exploited the environment way beyond its carrying capacity. Now, in this presentation, I've highlighted certain features, certain impacts industrialization has made. Next slide, please. Extinction of species due to habitat fragmentation, mainly due to creation of habitat islands, which have isolated populations into small batches, which are extremely vulnerable to even the smallest of climatic changes. Population fragmentation has also decreased the genetic variability. Inbreeding depression is the cause for it, thereby reducing the evolutionary fitness of the species. Next. These are certain pictures I've shown here. These are some anthropogenic activities related to fragmentation of habitats, for mining activities, construction of road, tourism, and for human settlements. The next impact of industrialization, as we all know, is heavy pollution. Since 1850s, since the Industrial Revolution, we have been constantly dumping hazardous and non-hazardous domestic and municipal waste into our environment, releasing greenhouse gases into our environment. Now, the State of Environment Report of Rajasthan has highlighted three major polluters of the state. One is its energy sector, which has been using a very poor quality coal, which contains about 30 to 40% ash, and the locally available lignite. The mining sector in Rajasthan is also one of the major polluters due to stone crushing, lime and cement kilns, and the various industries including the textile industries. Here we see some effects of the acid rain, acres of forest land being destroyed, fishes and aquatic life being killed, causing abrasion in the tissues of the plants. Next. Extreme coral bleaching episodes are being reported from shallow tropical waters due to high temperature sensitivity of these highly fragile and productive ecosystems. These are even referred to as the tropical forests of the oceans. The summers of 2010 saw the worst coral bleaching episodes in Southeast Asia and India and Indian Ocean, where there was a significant warming of tropical waters due to the El Nino effect. Next, we talk about the industrialization of agriculture. Now, modern agriculture is in the midst of transformation. The most direct negative effect of agriculture on biodiversity is due to considerable loss of natural habitat caused by the conversion of natural ecosystems into the agricultural land. Industrialization of agriculture has led to its commercialization, has led to excessive use of chemical fertilizers, pesticides, agricultural machinery, and high-yielding genetically modified crops. Next, please. Now, these are certain impacts which I have just mentioned here. As a result of industrialization of agriculture, pollution, degradation of land, depletion of ground and surface water resources, erosion of biodiversity, and pesticides, which have found its way at each and every trophic level of our food chain. Next, please. There are certain causes for erosion of biodiversity due to agricultural industrialization. Next, please. Deforestation has been a major cause of biodiversity loss. Subsistence farming accounts for 48% of deforestation and commercial agriculture for a further 32% of deforestation, according to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. It is currently estimated that the world is losing around 137 plant, animal and insect species every day due to deforestation. Extensive tillage and plowing operations in cultivation has led to destruction of soil integrity, including its microflora. Pesticide sprays have, as we have heard so much of talk on bee destruction, several catastrophic bee decline has been reported in various countries. Eutrophication is another cause, is another impact which we have due to excessive dumping of fertilizer nutrients into our water bodies, which has threatened the aquatic species all across. Next, please. Here we highlight the impact of climate change on global food production. The International Panel for Climate Change, IPCC, has reported an estimated rise in global temperatures by 1.4 to 5.8 degrees Celsius by 2100. And the following presumptions, following predictions have been made regarding agriculture, the agri-zones. Next, please. These are the predicted effects of climate change. Increase in carbon dioxide would have a positive physiological effect on certain species of crops, especially at the higher latitudes where the initial regimes were a little cooler. The C3 plants are presumed to increase in their yield. Increase in temperature will have a negative effect on the countries residing in the tropical and the subtropical nations because of a combined effect of increased temperature, evaporation and decreased precipitation in the regions. There are presumed cases for extreme weather conditions which are predicted over time. Next, please. About the agricultural zones which will be shifting towards the poles into the now occupied natural ecosystems, and the shift at mid-latitudes are expected to be 200 to 300 kilometers for every 1 degree Celsius.
Please conclude.
So the thing is, this is actually like an eye-opener for all of us that the global climate change has really threatened the food security system, because the world population has to grow, is expected to grow by 2.2 billion in the next 40 years, and the suggested decline in agricultural productivity is 15 to 30%, especially in the in the most exposed part of the world like Africa and South Asia. So my presentation is actually an eye-opener for all of us, because the process of industrialization is an inevitable process. But we can follow it in a more sustainable way, as said by the Brundtland Commission's Our Common Future report, that the development should go in a more sustainable way for ourselves and for our future generations. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much. Now we can.
Good evening, everyone. I know everybody is getting really late, so I'll hush up with my presentation. The topic of my presentation is biodiversity conservation under the Rajasthan Forestry and Biodiversity Project Phase 2. This is the project which has collaborated with our national conference, so I think a little bit information about this would be good. We can see a map of Rajasthan. We've marked the forestry and biodiversity regions of Rajasthan. 9.5% of the region is under the forest out of the total geographical area. We have 2 national parks, 25 wildlife sanctuaries, 2,500 plant species, 450 bird species, 50 mammal species, 20 reptiles and 14 amphibian species in Rajasthan. The two major issues that concern regarding the forestry and biodiversity are the changing climate and the population, which causes depletion of the forest regions. We'll take a look at the climate change in Rajasthan. In the 30 years ranging from 1982 to 2009, the mean temperature has risen about 3 degrees Celsius, and the annual trend of rainfall seems to have decreased. It has decreased 56.5 mm in the observed 30 years. The impact of forestry and biodiversity of Rajasthan due to these things has been that there can be shift of forest types, and also the species that are living in the forest are also under threat. Also, the exploitation levels have increased and the forest fires and carbon sinks are low in the region now. Also, the people have started, or the forest dependent communities have started more intrusion into this region. The Rajasthan government has taken a few initiatives like the Rajasthan State Compensatory Afforestation Fund Management and Planning Authority, Rajasthan Rural Livelihood Project, the State Forest Policy 2010, and the Rajasthan Forestry and Biodiversity Project Phase 2. All of them work to enhance the forest area and livelihood opportunities of the forest dependent communities and also preserve the biodiversity of Rajasthan. The ecosystems identified in Rajasthan according to this project are divided into 4: desert ecosystem, Aravali Hill ecosystem, Eastern Plain and Haroti region. These have been further divided into Canal Command Region, Non-Command Region, Luni Basin, Northern Aravali, Southern Aravali and Central Aravali region, the Chambal Basin and the Dang Basin region. So the project works in a very specified region for a specific work. The conservation strategies include the drainage line treatment, because of which the forest species, both the floral and the fauna, will have water so that they don't need to venture out of the forest, so that they can be preserved. The stone wall fencing project, under this the construction of the notified outer boundary only is done, and the greening inside the boundary of the area is done. A proper closure for biodiversity is constructed through masonry walls and also live hedges. In situ conservation of 4 highly vulnerable and indigenous species has been chosen. The two endangered species are 4-horned antelope and the great Indian bustard. And as far as the trees are concerned, Rohira and Khejdi are concerned, are conserved because they are extremely drought resistant and important to the biodiversity of Rajasthan. For ex situ conservation, for one such example has been taken, like the Machia Biological Park in Jodhpur has been established by the government of Rajasthan. Promotion of ecotourism activities helps the forest dependent communities to have more varied options. The protection of sacred groves is also done. Other than this, we have a few suggestions. There is a need to assess environmental vulnerability on regional level. The forest dependent communities should be given more socio-economic developmental programs, and the use of GIS and remote sensing techniques should be promoted in the state. Thank you.
Thank you very much for finishing before time. And now we invite Manali Dutta.
Application-based exploration and halophiles. Enzymes, as we all know, are used for various purposes in various industrial applications it is having. For example, in the paper industries, pulp industries, as well as several other industries. So here in our research work, we put emphasis on the halophiles and to extract enzymes from the halophiles so that they can be used for further industrial applications. Next slide. The halophiles are broadly classified as halophiles and salt-tolerant microorganisms, and halophiles are then further divided on the three like slight, moderate and extreme halophilic conditions on the basis of percentage of sodium chloride they are able to survive in. Next. Objectives of the study are isolation of the halophiles from the Sambar Lake, Rajasthan, then the microbiological characteristic and the molecular characterization of the selected strain of the halophile. Next, please. Now, the isolation of the halophile from the Sambar Lake, in it, first we collected the soil from the Sambar Lake and then we suspended in a buffer, and which was PBS 0.1 molar. After that, the buffer was used for plating by the serial dilution method. After that, the unique colony was identified based on the colony characteristics and physical characteristics. Next, please. The microbiological characterization was done with the help of these seven tests like gram staining and other catalase test and IMVIC and others. Next, ma'am. After that, the enzymatic activity detection was done for the three enzymes like amylase and the other two. It's not visible to me very nicely. The molecular characterization of the halophiles was done in this. The extraction of DNA was done by cell lysis. Then the purity check was done by electrophoresis and the molecular identification was done by amplification by PCR and then sequence analysis. The sequence analysis in the amplified DNA was then submitted to TCGA where the two chromatograms were given. And they were then sequenced and the sequence was compiled using the 8 forward primer and 1492 reverse primer, and using the cluster omega, the 1414 base pair length product was obtained to us. Ma'am, next slide. After this, the result which we concluded was the strain which we isolated from Sambar Lake was having the similarity with the Halomena species and with the 99% peri coverage and the 99% sequence similarity. Next, ma'am. Then we, from the UPGMA method, we did the phylogenetic tree analysis. In it, we saw that the Halomena species, the isolated strain had the most similarity with the Halomena species. In it, the species was Halomena celadifona. Next. So these are the conclusions that we can draw. The species was very unique, so to identify it, the 16S RNA marker technique was applied, and this Halomena species, in it, from it, enzymes can be extracted which are high temperature resistant and high salt resistance are also. They can be further used as the detergents, and various other industrial applications are there. Thank you so much.
Respected Chairman sir, distinguished faculty members of IIS University and other faculty members, I am going to discuss about synthesis of anti-cancer and anti-obesity factor from xerophytic plant, that is Belonitis cinereata. Actually, we synthesized CLA, that is conjugated linoleic acid, from fruit of Belonitis aegyptiaca. You know, the Belonitis aegyptiaca is a xerophytic plant which can thrive in desert. It requires very less amount of water and its fruits are having very good amount of oil. The oil yield is around 40%, which is equivalent to almost your jatropha plants. That is edible oil also, and it can be used as a your biodiesel also. So we have used its covering, that is pericarp of the fruit, for getting oil, and that oil was further utilized to produce CLA. The CLA are the compounds which can be used as anti-obesity and other activities purpose. Like, these compounds are important because they have anti-carcinogenic effect, they have anti-adipogenic activities, means they don't allow fats to be getting deposited. So they are increasing immunity also, they have antioxidant effect also, they can increase body protein, they can improve bone formation. So we can say that they can be used for pharmaceutical and other dietary supplements.
the two major forms of CLA are 9, 11 and 10, 12. From the first, the A figure shows you linoleic acid. B and C, they are the isomers of CLA. Actually, CLA means conjugated linoleic acid, means it is having double bonds which are which are separated by a single bond. Otherwise, your double bonds are separated by two single bonds. So, what is the natural source of CLA? Natural source of CLA are dairy products, meat, and in general, people use around 50 to 500 milligram of this CLA as a dietary material. Objective of the present study was to isolate free fatty acids from Bennett's aegyptiaca, then separation of linoleic acid from the mixture, and then bioconversion of linoleic acid to CLA. Basically, CLA is synthesized in our body because we are having certain kind of bacteria in our gut. They can convert this linoleic acid to CLA. But we can give the CLA as a food supplement also, which will improve our immunity and which will give us better anti-carcinogenic effect. So we collect the fruit. From fruit we separated this pericarp. Then using succinate apparatus we got separated oil using N-hexane. Then hexane was evaporated and the oil was collected. Oil is mixture of fatty acids. So these for the fatty acids were analyzed by first we converted fatty acid into FAM, that is fatty acid methyl esters, and then we further analyzed using GC, gas chromatography. The oil, from this oil we separated linoleic acid using crystallization method. Then this separated linoleic acid was further subjected to culture with lactobacillus casei, which is generally we take in the form of your Sporlac tablets. So from the Sporlac tablet only we revived those bacteria, and with that culture we inoculated this oil, means linoleic acid oil component. Then it was CLA was synthesized and it was detected using GC. The result shows that oil contained in the pericarp is around 19.56%, and I should tell you that the seeds, the kernel, are having 40% oil, and this is the oil here which we got. It is having 75.8% linoleic acid, and the linoleic acid was further converted to conjugated linoleic acid. These are the peaks which we got for the crude oil, and the last peak shows your CLA. So conclusion is that from desert also we can get good food supplements. Thank you.
I invite Neha 424.
Thank you so much, sir. Since we have been talking about biodiversity, my topic of presentation would be photosynthetic performance and drought-induced changes in antioxidative enzymes and different varieties of IGNA radiata in arid and semi-arid region. Next, please. Okay, among various stresses, drought we know is a major stress in Rajasthan, and effects of drought, I'll be very brief. Effects of drought stress are majorly on growth, then the fluorescence characteristic, then we have photosynthetic pigments, and then the ROS is generated as a result of drought, and which modulates antioxidant enzymes. Next, please. This is the importance of IGNA radiata, Mang B. IGNA radiata is an important family, and we know in Rajasthan this is a major protein, major source of Asia's malnourished population, because it's a major source of protein. Then it could be also provide farmers with income generating opportunities and diversification of agro ecosystems. Next, please. Next. This is IGNA radiata in field. Next. The objectives of the study was screening of different varieties of Inari data. We chose 5 varieties which were obtained from KVK Banasli University. And then further evaluation of 2 selected varieties, that is the tolerant variety as well as the sensitive variety of Vigna radiata, using photosynthetic pigment content and activities of antioxidant enzymes. These are the materials and method section. We took seeds, then the seeds were sown, and then we measured in-field photosynthetic performance of the varieties, 5 varieties, 2 varieties were selected, and then we proceeded for drought treatment. Okay, so this is the instrument, Mini PAM from Germany, by which we measured chlorophyll A fluorescence parameters. Next, please. Okay, these are the method and methodology of pigments, antioxidant enzymes. Next, please. These are the results. Coming to the results and discussions, these are the 5 varieties we chose for in-field photosynthetic performance. Next, please. Okay, these are the daily courses of incident PPFD, yield, ETR and FMO 5 varieties. Next, please. This is a tabulated form. The yield was found to be the best in variety RNG268 and least in variety Anand. Next. These are again comparative NPQ and FVYFM. Next. So I saying need to hurry up. Okay. So these are the individual readings of cardinal points, regression lines, scatters and regression line. Next, please. These are the readings of variety RNG268. You can see that variety RNG268 has the highest values as compared to variety Anand. Next, please. Therefore, we can conclude that variety RNG268 tended to reach the highest values. Hence, it is considered as tolerant, whereas variety Anand is considered as sensitive. Next, please. Then we proceeded for drought stress. These are photographs of drought stress. Variety RNG268. Next. Variety Anand. Next. These are the tabulated form of chlorophyll content. Variety RNG268 retained a better photosynthetic pigment values. Next. So a major conclusion could be that because it maintained a better photosynthetic pigment, a better photosynthetic rate was maintained by variety RNG268 in drought stress. Next. These are the changes in antioxidant enzymes in leaves of variety Vigna radiata. Again, a variety RNG268, the accumulation was more in comparison to variety Anand. Next. So effect, the increased activities may detected in this study are presumed to limit cellular damage. Next. In summary, we can conclude that variety RNG268 was better, can be considered as tolerant. Next. Antioxidant system could be used as a better index of oxidative stress under drought stress condition in varieties of Vigna radiata. Next. Future implications, it could be used in agriculture. Somebody in the morning said that we should carry research to the fields, and this is a practical application of this. Next, please. My acknowledgements to my sir and ma'am. Next, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Just 1 to 2 minutes, please.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, well, warm good evening to all in this full condition of this auditorium. I'm here to present my work on in vitro regulation and anti-malarial efficacy of new source of retinoids, that Acacia dura. Now, the quest for good health and happiness has been a continuous endeavor of mankind since time immemorial, and this has led to development of several doctrines of medicines as well as several formulations of which plants are integral part. So, it's not wrong if I quote as plants, humans' best friend. Now, plants are regarded as molecular factories because they contain myriads of compounds primarily categorized as primary and secondary. Secondary metabolites are not needed for growth and development but have ecological role, ensuring the plant's survival in its ecosystem. And the best part is that we can produce this in tissue culture, and which is one of the major breakthrough of plant biotechnology. And various factors affect the response of tissue culture. Coming to my experimental plant, Acacia dura, all I've written according to its traditional uses, and it's also used as slim tea in China. Now, I cultured that plant using nodal explant on various concentrations of auxins and cytokines, and lower concentration of 240 basically was not able to induce callus. The maximum callusing was obtained on 240 Na and carnitin as 2.5, 2.5 and 0.02 milligrams per liter. Callus was brown and compact. You can see here initially the callus was off-white in color, which later turned light brown, and finally When the subculturing was done after 8 weeks, few, very few freshly dividing cells, off-white in color, appeared. And the problem basically was because of the secretion and formation of phenolics within the tissue culture as well as in media. There are various ways like antioxidants used in the media, then you can use charcoal, but I used a very, you can say, commercially beneficial, that is subculturing before it gets to this state, that is subculturing within 4 to 5 weeks. So that led to the formation of freshly dividing callus culture, which was again beneficial. This was the growth index, a sigmoid curve, maximum growth index in 6 weeks and least 2 weeks. So I then went ahead with isolation and identification of few secondary metabolites, basically retinoids, which are very important, and they are part of isoflavone group. These were the isolated retinoids, which was confirmed with a preliminary study of TLC, that's thin layer chromatography, using chloroform, acetone and acetic acid. One of the important fact is that unless and until you heat the TLC plate till 110 degrees centigrade, you don't find the spots, and that's very important because generally we go ahead with 100 degrees centigrade so as to visualize the spot. Now it was also confirmed with specific, that is GLC analysis, and it confirmed the isolated retinoids which I reported, which I told just in the earlier slide. And the isolated compound B is from root and the C is from callus culture. This shows that different plant parts possess different, you can say, retinoid content, and this again gives us a conclusion about the specific activity and of the secondary metabolites, that they are produced in certain specialized cells which can be organ specific. Now, I guess we took a statement earlier that need again leads to greed. So just to come over with this problem again, and the problem we are having of ever increasing demand for phytocompounds, I use precursors in the media so that I have more of a harvest of the metabolites so that it can be used further. I use phenylalanine and methionine with 0.05 millimolar concentration each, and others 0.025 and 0.1. The best growth index was observed in 0.05 millimolar concentration of each of the precursors. Same for the retinoid content, and it's worth to mention that the content increased 1.18 times than that of the control as shown in the graph here. And now the work is not over, in my opinion, and until you go ahead with the establishing the bioefficacy of the isolated compounds, because that's the need of the hour. And now that's why I went ahead with analyzing its larvicidal activity and one of the most dreaded disease, that's of malaria. It's vector-borne disease, and WHO has reported that 3.4 billion people at risk of malaria. So I tried to use the efficacy of this isolated metabolite on larva of Anopheles stephensi, and here you can see on the table that the IC50, or you can say the LC50, this is lethal concentration 50, was 120 ppm of the extract of retinoid, and isolated retinol had only 3.2 milligrams per liter. That is quite significant. And this again can be further used for your integrated pest management, wherein we need several biopesticides, because there are several resistant varieties that have been developed because of the use of synthetic insecticides. DDT was one of the example, and you know there is mutation on and off in various organisms. So this was done, and that finally proved the not only the isolation part but also the efficacy of the isolated metabolite. And I'm a bit proud to mention that this is the first ever report in the world on this plant, and in terms of anti-malarial efficacy as well as isolation of retinoids. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Very good. I invite...
I'll directly come forward on the topic and the conclusions. A study on biodiversity of arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi associated with the rhizosphere of Phoenix retiaeifera in arid and semi-arid soils. Next please. Mycorrhizal is a symbiotic association between various plants and the root system. They have wide variety of beneficial effects. They are responsible for the growth of the plant, for better water absorption, for resistance against wide variety of stress and diseases. Next please. Next please. Next. 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 The objective of the study was to assess the mycorrhizal status of the date palms, to isolate and identify a wide variety of VAM species, and to calculate the root colonization percentage of the species. Next please. Next. 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 Result. The survey showed that, that there was a universal occurrence of different VAM species. It's varied to a various extent. Mycorrhizal richness was observed at all the sites which were studied. Arbuscles, vesicles and sporocarp were seen. Next please. Total 11 species were isolated from 15 localities. Zygospora species was found in abundance, which was followed by Glomus, Glutulospora, Sclerocystin and Entrophosphora. Next please. These are the 15 sites where the research was carried out. Next please. These are different species. Next. 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 This is important. The study showed that the white VAM fungal diversity was found in the rhizosphere of date palms. And if we can isolate these species and prepare various inoculum of it, then it can be used for mass multiplication and it can be used on commercial level for enhancing date palm production. Because of their natural occurrence, these inoculants will certainly prove better than usually selected strains of VAM fungi. Next please. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
On the importance of biodiversity, my first today my topic of presentation is isolation and screening of azo-dye decolorizing bacterial isolates from dye contaminated textile wastewater collected from Pali, Rajasthan. Why I have chosen Pali? Because Pali is a small town situated in Rajasthan which is famous for its textile units, dyeing industry, but it is not in the news for its cheap and economical production of cotton clothes. It is always in news for wrong reasons, like textile units polluting water in Pali. It is an industrial area which is situated around the river Bandi, which is a seasonal river and highly polluted with the industrial waste or effluents coming out from the textile units. So, according to the CAC, that is Center for Science and Environment, it is critically polluting industrial area, which is polluting the water level of Bandi River. Next. So I have chosen Pali River for my study, and from this Pali area I have collected the textile wastewater from the CETP. CETP is the first of its type of initiative by the Government of India to set up some wastewater treatment plant in Pali to treat this type of wastewater. Next. I have collected my sample from four different sites of CETP, that is inlet, primary clarifloculator, aeration tank and the outlet. Next. So first panel shows the four different sites from where I have collected the water and the sludge sample. From that samples we have isolated the indigenous microorganisms. I have used the dye, that is azo dye, which is red in color on the basis of the most prevalent use of this dye in the textile industry. It is a dye azo dye. The chemical structure shows this. Next. So the objective of my study is morphological and biochemical characterization of the isolates that I have isolated from the wastewater, characterization of dye degrading bacteria by molecular characterization, and then optimization of culture condition for better and efficient dye decolorization. Next. Why I have chosen azo dye? Because it is most commonly used dye in textile industry, and the production shows that more than 1 million tons are produced worldwide. There are 2,000 different chemical structures of azo dye. I have chosen Congo Red, which is a dye azo dye with sulfonated group attached to it, which makes it a xenobiotic component. Next. So we have used very simple method. We have collected the wastewater and the sludge sample from Pali area, and the bacterial isolation was done by serial dilution method. Then media we have used is BHM. We have done qualitative quantitative estimation of dye decolorization using that bacterial inoculum. Next. We have also optimized the process by OFAT approach. Next. We have isolated following bacterial strain. So I have exploited the natural bacterial diversity, indigenous bacterial diversity thriving in that highly polluted wastewater, which are capable of decolorizing the toxic dyes. Next. Biochemical characterization. Next. It has further been proved by molecular characterization. Next. 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 we have optimized the culture condition and we have got better results in terms of dye decolorization. Next. So this is the graph which shows that when we inoculate the bacteria with optimum conditions and some supplements of carbon and nitrogen, they show better decolorization efficiency. Next. So this is the first panel shows the qualitative assay to show that how the bacterial colony inoculation, when we inoculate single colony in the solid media, how the zone of clearance or decolorization zone is created around the bacterial colonies. And the second is the picture showing the decolorization in the liquid culture.
Conclude,
next,
please.
Next. So, it's like, so azoreductase enzyme is basically involved in it, which is decolorizing the dye. And the enzyme is both extracellular as well as intracellular. We are isolating the enzyme by sonication and other enzymatic treatment and purifying the enzyme, and ultimately we are doing SDS page to characterize. Thank you.
Thank you. As chairperson of this session, I must admit that we are heading towards academic destruction, because these things normally not processed in any of the seminar, but looking to the paucity of the time as well as the strength of the audience, I must again apologize for it, and I invite few more speakers who are with us. Kalpana, for 2 more minutes only, 2 minutes, yeah, and Shilpi. Hi.
Chair need not apologize. It is the participant's folly. Chair has not to apologize.
Chair has to apologize simply because that I could not maintain the time which was given to me. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So the speaker should have only 2 slides, the first one and the last one. Please.
Namaskar. I'm going to present my presentation on drought tolerance studies in genus Cassia L in Rajasthan. First, I would like to present an overview, next please, of the vegetation that exists in the central part of Rajasthan. It's an ecotone zone, the Ajmer region, and it's also the dunal part is also characterized or classified as scrub jungle, and we see that it is mostly dominated by perennial shrubs, and trees are lacking, and the dominant shrubs are Leptodena, Crotalaria buria, Ziziphus, Ava, and so on and so forth. The annual vegetation is mostly characterized by ephemerals and seen only during the rainy season. Next please, these are few shrubs that we see, Leptodena on the right side, and left side we have Ava tomentosa. Next. We must admit that we experience conditions of ecological adversity in the central region, because neither the climatic factors are favorable nor the edaphic ones, and on top that we have biotic stresses. The soil is poor in humus, the water retaining capacity is poorer, the microbial flora is not able to survive because the soil is baked hot. And the most disastrous role is played by the erratic rainfall. And amongst the annuals, we see only those plants that are able to compete and complete their life cycle within a very short span of time. Next. The temperatures are hostile, ranging from 45 degrees in summer months and going to as low as 2 degrees in the winter months. And diurnal variation is very, very great. And the permanent vegetation that we expect, even if the conditions are favorable, cannot exist because of this great diurnal variation in temperature. And that is why we see low percentage of tree species. Next. The biotic stresses are too heavy. Wherever vegetation grows, in spite of this difficult and discouraging conditions, it gets a detrimental treatment at the hands of the biotic factors. And tree species are logged, and domestic animals are the worst enemies of the vegetation. Next. Here we see tree species, and on the left side we see that lopping has been done. Next. And the Cassia, which is the genus under study, is represented in this present presentation. by three species, Keshia auriculata on the right, Keshia fistula in the center, and Keshia obtusifolia. Next. Keshia is a very adaptable species because it, in spite of the hostile climatic conditions, it has been found to grow in significant numbers, and we hereby in this paper evaluate the ecophysiological characteristics that impart drought tolerance adaptability to them. Next. The foliar mineral contents were evaluated, and we saw them that they were found to be maximum in Keshia auriculata and least in Keshia obtusifolia, and the leaf litter upon decomposition liberates quantities of these minerals in the form of humus, which is responsible for specific associates that grow near these plants. Next. This is the representation of the foliar contents. Next. This is the graphical representation. Next. Moisture content was also evaluated in terms of total bound water and the moisture content in all the three species. Next. Next. Proline estimation was done to assess the drought tolerance in all the three species. Of all the plant parts that were investigated, leaf was found to have maximum content of proline, and amongst all the species that were evaluated, Keshia auriculata showed the maximum percentage of proline, so it can be regarded as the most drought tolerant species. Next. 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 This is the effect of hyperthermia on pigment stability. It was assessed on chlorophyll stability and carotenoid stability at varying temperatures at 40, 42 and 45 degrees centigrade for 1 hour, 2 hour and 4 hours. And chlorophyll loss of chlorophyll content was maximum in obtusifolia and the degradation was minimum in auriculata. Next. This is the next. And we saw an adverse relationship wherever in Keshia auriculata the chlorophyll degradation was lowest, but carotenoid degradation was highest in Keshia auriculata, and the reverse was true for Keshia obtusifolia. That's it. Thank you.
Very good. So, slide number one and slide last.
Oral 21. Nagwar. And my topic is, I'm not remembering my topic, through management of abiotic stress. As we know, biodiversity is the web of the life, and what we heard in the morning, biodiversity is life and biodiversity is our life. But biodiversity is decreasing day by day because of the increasing pollution and increasing population. And because of the increasing pollution, abiotic stress is increasing. Mineral nutrients, mineral contents are increasing in the soil, especially salinity and heavy metals, and they are posing a great problem to the growth of the crops. And these abiotic stresses are mainly causing a nutritional imbalance to the crop, due to which the yield is decreased very much. So what is the need of the hour is to combat the abiotic stress. If we want to increase the yield, we have to combat the abiotic stresses. If we perform the studies in by breeding techniques, this is a time-consuming and labor-consuming process. So what I have decided is I perform my studies under in vitro conditions. And in my previous studies, I have found that mineral nutrient variation can lead to increase of morphogenetic response. So in this study, I tried to combat the abiotic stresses by variations in the mineral nutrient composition. Now I want to tell you about the conclusions. It was found that especially nickel toxicity and cadmium toxicity was very high in Eleusine coracana. I have taken Eleusine as a model plant because Eleusine is mainly grows in the condition which faces saline conditions and heavy metal toxicity. And Eleusine is a very rich millet. It is a millet which is very rich in methionine, and it is nutritionally very rich, and its production needs to be improved. So it was found that cadmium and nickel toxicity was very high, and cadmium toxicity could be overcome by the use of magnesium, by the use of zinc sulfate, and nickel toxicity can be overcome by the use of magnesium sulfate. That's all. Thank you so much.
Namaskar everyone. I am presenting my research work entitled Optimization of Cobalt Fluoride for Improved Shoot Morphogenesis in Cuminum Simonum. Next. Here in my work, I'm emphasizing the potential of plant tissue culture and conservation of biotechnology, conservation of germplasm of some important plants. Now, cumin is an important seed spice, and it is grown as a rabi crop in India. It is mainly cultivated in Gujarat and Rajasthan, and it is cultivated to such an extent that both the states account for more than 95% of country's production. Next. Now, cumin is commonly known as zeera, which in Sanskrit means it aids in digestion, it improves digestion. So besides being used as a seed spice, it is also used to improve digestion, improve lactation and enhance your appetite. Besides, it is used as a carminative, and also it is used against certain ailments like insomnia and asthma. Next. So although it is extensively cultivated in these areas, but still there are certain problems related to its cultivation, like it has low seed set, which is definitely a stress for the production of this commercially important crop. Secondly, the seed population is highly heterogeneous. The plant is susceptible to frost and it is threatened by various diseases and pests. And most importantly, in India, cumin is grown as a rabi crop, so it has a seasonal nature because it is not available throughout the year. Next. So therefore, tissue culture technologies could circumvent some of these constraints, like it could definitely increase the productions. Secondly, it could complement the programmed spice industry so that the spice could be made available throughout the year. And it could give an access to clean and disease-free uniform plants. Next. So basically my work was conducted in two phases. The first part of my phase, it comprised of optimization of a regeneration protocol for this plant. And I worked on variety RZ19, which was procured from SKN Agriculture College, Jodhpur. The seeds of this variety were aseptically germinated on filter paper bridges. And then the cotyledonary node explants were excised and they were inoculated on induction medium, then proliferation medium, and finally the complete plantlets were raised and they were taken to field conditions. Next. Now the second aspect of my study comprises of to study the effect of cobalt chloride. Next. Next. Now this is the main slide which shows the results. Here we can see that as we improve the, as we increase the level of cobalt chloride, the number of shoots also increase. So cobalt chloride at a level of 50 times than that of MS medium, they gave threefold increase in the number of shoots. Next. Next. So finally we can conclude that cotyledonary nodes come out to be the excellent explants for cumin, giving a regeneration response. Next. Second is the cobalt chloride at a level of 5.5 micromoles were optimized for proper regeneration and shoot morphogenesis in cumin. Thank you. My work, research work entitled Incorporation of Silver Nitrate in the Culture Media Improves In Vitro Regeneration Efficiency of Capsicum Annuum Linearis. Next please. Capsicum is a new world genus from the nightshade family which was originated and cultivated in the American tropics. There are a wide variety of these species which are known, and 27 species of capsicum are known worldwide, of which 5 have been domesticated and are currently cultivated. These are some of the pictures of capsicum species in nature: Capsicum annuum, frutescens, chinans, pecatum and pubescens. Next please. Capsicum is an indispensable ingredient in the culinary art. Besides being used as a spice, it has also very important nutritive profile. But there are several problems which are associated with capsicum production, like susceptibility of peppers to various fungi, bacteria and viruses. Viruses alone account for approximately 60% of the total loss to the standing crop, which is a great threat to capsicum. Low seed viability, germination rates, cross-pollination is also a constraint, and the capsicum cultivation is also prone to frost. Next, please. Conventional breeding methods have been of immense value for genetic improvement of capsicum, but biotechnological tools involving plant tissue culture and recombinant DNA technologies could be supplementary techniques for accelerating this goal. Since these techniques are easy, efficient and economic means for production of disease-free, consistently uniform, true to the type plants within a short span of time. But unfortunately, capsicum is recalcitrant in nature with regard to its in vitro regeneration potential, which makes it difficult to apply recombinant DNA technologies via genetic transformation.
So, keeping this in view and for overcoming the recalcitrant nature of capsicum, we have investigated the effect of AgNO3 on regeneration potential of capsicum. Next, please. Next. This slide shows the effect of AgNO3 on induction of shoot buds, wherein incorporation of 18 micromoles of AgNO3 to the culture media improved the regeneration response of capsicum, and approximately 16 to 17 shoot buds were induced per explant. Next, please. Similar levels of AgNO3 was found to be optimum for elongation of shoots as well. So incorporation of AgNO3 to the culture medium improved regeneration efficiency of capsicum. Next. This is the rooting response of capsicum plantlets which were regenerated in vitro. Next. These are the field transferred regenerated plantlets of capsicum. Next, please. These are the conclusions. Cotyledons was found to be the best explant for regeneration response, and the best hormonal combination was BAP 5 mg per liter in combination with PA 2 mg per liter. Among different concentrations of AgNO3 varied in MS media, 18 micromoles of the heavy metal was found to be optimal for induction of shoot buds, and similar levels were found to be optimum for elongation of shoot as well. AgNO3 added exogenously to the culture media significantly improved regeneration response, which is a constraint in capsicum tissue culture. Thank you.